Hi, welcome to the Greg Sterle Show. Greg's running a little bit late, so I'm going to take over as the host for right now. I'm Suzanne Taylor, and I'm here with four Buffalo comics.
Three.
I'm going to count myself as one, if you don't
Okay.
mind.
Oh.
We'll
You
keep
said
that
you were here
farce up for a little
with.
while.
You said you were here with.
Total. It's true.
Total.
And they're not confrontational at all.
Non-confrontational.
So that would be Kristen over there, and Kristen Becker, Brian Herberger. And to my right is Kevin Carlin, and I'll be playing the part of Suzanne Taylor, the comic. Shut up.
I was just didn't want you to. I was all right.
So all of us perform pretty much every week at least open mic at Nietzsche's
Yes.
at the Do and Time Comedy Showcase every Tuesday at Nietzsche's.
8 o'clock.
8 o'clock.
Ish.
$3.
$3.
$3 American.
$3
Or I don't
American.
know, maybe they give on that.
I'd go par at this point.
Ooh.
Excellent.
I'd go par.
I'm going to get all the Canadians to flood across
Canadian
the border.
Canadian money at par.
Yeah, it's only a dime now. It's not even a discount.
A dime's a dime.
A dime's a dime. A Canadian dime's another matter. So we were talking before about Kevin having extremely girlish fingers. Did you?
No, that's not true.
Okay.
As his hands are placed
never.
Deeply in his pockets.
Yeah. As he places a call
they
to
are
his
gonna.
Bar.
They're gonna enhance these after the show. So
yeah,
be big.
These are the enhanced versions.
They'll be big
of
Mickey
your
Mouse
fingers.
Hands by the end.
You're gonna make me look like such an inadequate.
Well, no, you're gonna get scars.
I'm gonna get scars.
So you'll
That'll
look really
get the
tough.
Chicks. That really picks up the chicks. Scarred,
nice.
Mauled hands. You're gonna
we're
put
gonna
that where?
Take off a ring finger.
Well, see, here's we're gonna draw a line here. Kevin and I are on this side because we are the most inexperienced among the comics here. So we're gonna show a couple bits that Kevin and I did. You can look for his girlish fingers. You can look for mine if you'd like to. And then after that, we're gonna talk about getting started in comedy, and then we're gonna go to the experienced people and see what they
I think
can
that
do.
You and I.
Are you experienced?
All right.
Some guys.
So it wasn't just the alcohol. Okay, this is scary. So you have to stay off the internet and take the battery out of your cell phone if you have anything at all to hide. Go ahead, I'll wait. Go ahead. I've met you guys. And on top of it, Google, when you use Google, the end user agreement gives them permission to save all of your searches in perpetuity. So we played this fun game where we all switched laptops and did searches. And now she's searching for Volvos, and we don't know why. And, so this was really creepy. But then there was more alcohol involved, and I thought, you know, we got people who are keeping track of where I am with my cell phone. We got people keeping track of what I'm interested with on the internet. We got Google keeping track of all the questions that I need answers to. Why do I still have to save receipts? They know everything about me now. Okay, but here's where the. So now that I know that everybody knows everything about me and they follow me wherever I go, and I don't care. I left my laptop on the internet. I don't care if they know. I think what we need to do is stop letting it make us feel vulnerable and take control. Because the FBI is funded by us, right? So they have all the information. They should provide a service. Hello, FBI. Yeah, it's Suzanne. Yeah, I'm almost done at the mall, so I was wondering where I parked. Oh, and also, which store was I in when I called my sister? Because I want to go back and get that blouse before I leave. Yeah, I'll hold. Uh-huh. So, think about it. Think about this. All the illegal wiretapping of ordinary Americans. We've got these highly trained specialists, the FBI, listening to ordinary Americans and following them. Like if they're following me, they're gonna get, okay, she's leaving the house. She's walking to the mailbox. Evidently, she forgot her mailbox key again. Back in the house.
Yeah, this is totally
mailbox. Okay, here's something interesting. She's ignoring the paycheck and going right to the postcard from her mother. Yeah, write that down. That's suspicious. But the guys who do the wiretapping, I mean, think about what they're listening to. They're listening to all the inane phone conversations that we are forced to overhear. Right? You know? No, I'm at the movie. Uh-huh. Yeah, it already started. No, that's okay. I can hear you right here. That's what they're listening to. And so we've got these highly trained specialists who, you know everything about language and subtlety and accents, and they're listening to, okay, is that I told him? Like, if I have to tell you what's wrong, I can't even tell you what's wrong. Because presumably, according to George Bush, on the other end of the line, is Osama bin Laden going, uh-huh, uh-huh. Oh, wait. Oh, must have gone video equipment. No, no, be far behind the uh-huh. Oh, you said that? Well, you know how men are.
Thank you very much, everyone.
It was recently I learned the hard way that I suck at dealing with hecklers, so what I want to do is I want to do some old stuff for you, and I want you guys to heckle me. And like, I'm serious, and show me no mercy even if I beg for it. However, the heckler stop safety word for tonight will we'll make it Bert and Ernie, all right? You guys ready? I'm serious, though. I found this out recently. Did you guys know that in South Africa they train their dogs to be racist? Anybody ever heard of that or been there? It's true. And not only is that messed up, but that blows my mind because it took me a month to teach my dog to sit.
That's amazing.
Like, I can't imagine the time and effort it would take to teach him to hate an entire culture. Or even imagine hating anyone that much. Not even like workers at the DMV or airport security guards. I will confess, when I found that out, I did think about teaching him to hate frat boys, just because it'd be kind of funny and easy. Every day you play Dave Matthews for 20 minutes and beat him with a stick. Okay, see, that was the entire bit. I just made it through the whole bit and you didn't heckle me. I'm serious about this. Stop. Thank you.
Best Buy employee.
I am a Best Buy employee. That's excellent. See, that's a horrible comeback. That's why I need to work on this.
He just agrees. You, sir, are
seriously
correct.
All right, I work a crappy day job right now. Anyone work a crappy day job?
Yeah.
Yes. All right, it's not Best Buy. I'm actually a line cook. And even that's a step up for me. Last summer, I drove an ice cream truck.
Yes.
Which would have... It would have been a cool job, except that this was the most ghetto ice cream truck I've ever seen. The thing was falling apart. No brakes. It took all my strength to stop it, which seems especially sadistic when you consider that this is the one vehicle on the road that it's okay for kids to run out in front of. You would think a good brake job would come before actual ice cream. Cruising around, playing my jingle, kids are running out, like, ice cream, I want chocolate. I'm like, sorry, kid, I don't have any ice cream, but didn't run over you and you ran out in front of me. That's kind of a refreshing treat. That'll be $2.50.
I love that line.
That'll be
Yeah, so now I'm a line cook. The only thing I hate about restaurants is I keep having nightmares about work. You guys ever get those? Work nightmares? Right on. No, they suck, but I just feel like we should be getting paid for those hours, you know? Unless I'm clocked in and sleeping in the back room, then I should get overtime. I think the thing that makes the work nightmare so much scarier than the regular nightmare is that all that stuff can really happen. Like, when you wake up from a regular nightmare, you relax the second you realize where you are. You're like, oh, I'm in my room. I'm in no danger. The nearest known river of molasses is over 1,000 miles away. Not gonna get chased through it by an army of Teletubbies. When you wake up from a work nightmare and you realize you're in your room, you're sweating worse. You're like, I gotta be there in 4 hours. That stuff could all come true. It wouldn't even be the first time I showed up naked.
That's true, isn't it?
I do. I like cooking, I do, but
where do you
my friends all seem to assume that since I cook for a living, I eat really good at home. Which is like totally unfair, because no matter how, like, I've cooked at some fancy places, but no matter how fancy the stuff I cook at work, I'll always eat ramen at home. And they just refuse to accept that. They're like, dude, man, you're a chef. How can you eat ramen noodles at home? I'm like, dude, man, you're a janitor. How come your apartment's filthy? I missed the heckle. What was it?
Weaver!
Yeah! The hecklers are way better than me tonight, but...
That's Ian. Well, apparently Greg Sterling still isn't here, so I'm going to keep going on with the show.
We won't tell him.
I don't know, man. You crack me up, Kevin.
Did you just call me Auto Man?
I said, I don't know, man. Hey, Auto Man. You're an Auto Man. How'd you come up with the heckling thing? Were you really heckled?
Well, actually, because what happened was the next week I like made it into Heckle Club. You guys know that, but like Fight Club rules. And then the week after that, I realized that heckling's a lot easier to deal with than something else, so I made Not Listening at All Club. And I was like, the original problem was I was doing a show at Comics, and like everybody was drunk and just having side conversations. They weren't even heckling me, but I just couldn't go up against them. So I was like, I need to start learning to go up against rude crowds. So I figured heckling's the best way to go.
And there's no, well, you guys, I'm sure you've had your share.
Of heckling?
People, no, people who just don't listen. I mean, that's the biggest problem is going to a club where you're just standing up and going, look, I got 3 more minutes. I'm just going to keep talking no matter what you do.
Sometimes if you can pick on people, then the crowd kind of joins you. There's somebody easy to pick on, I guess.
Unless you pick on them too hard.
Kind of high school was like that,
too.
And
they hit you. Yeah.
That's true.
Like, it is kind of like high school.
It's a lot like high school.
You have thoughts. They don't like them.
Everybody's drunk.
Everybody's drunk.
Scary.
Is it Auto Man like O-T-T-O or like A-U-T-O? Like?
I was thinking O-T-T-O like the Simpsons bus driver.
Okay.
You know that so fits.
Auto Man's jacket.
I was thinking like, what was the jug band? Wasn't it Otto, the jug band, the Muppets jug band? I just pictured you with like a washboard all of a sudden with your manly hands.
Wow, we're turning into a high school clique.
What's that?
We're picking on him for the ladylike fingers.
The you know what? At least he's got a purpose, okay? And that gives him a purpose in our clique.
I feel left out. I'm like the only guy with man hands now.
Have you seen these before?
I'm the outsider. This is weird.
I'm the only one with a beer, so what does that mean?
And you're the only
fedora.
One with a hat. You're one of these things is not like the others.
That's because... what?
Huh?
What about this is not similar? Man hands? That's man true. Hat? I man
think,
boots?
I think all of these things man are not beer. Like the others.
You go with yourself. I'm saying one of these things is not like the other.
Oh.
Yeah, you match fine, but...
Note
care.
The person drinking the beer took a long time to catch on to the Sesame Street reference.
It's not so much the beer today as the
this
beer last
this is pretty
night.
Much what we were talking about, trying to do comedy with the drunk crowd.
Yeah.
Are you guys done? What?
Exactly.
Labatt Blue and ADD, two great tastes that go great together.
Taste great and less filling. Because you can't concentrate long enough to fill you up.
Oh, Lord. All right. Well, I just started doing comedy. I went on stage for the first time March 21st. Mm-hmm. And you've been doing it for a year and a half?
About that, yeah.
And you guys have been just doing it much longer.
Herbert, so what about
you? About 3.5 years. My first night was the night before Thanksgiving.
Classic,
big
so
night,
everybody was sober
night.
And well-behaved.
Speaking of drunks, yeah.
Where were you?
It was an open mic at Comics.
Oh, yeah? So.
It was packed. It was good.
And what made you go on?
I wanted to, and I don't know. I watched it for a while, and I said, "Hey, I could do this." So I went up there, and I don't really remember what happened. I just kind of like passed out, zoned out, and then I got off, and everybody said I did great. So I kept doing it.
And do those people still come to your shows?
Oh yeah, you guys at least.
We do at least. All right. Well, we're gonna show a clip from Brian from last week, I believe.
Let's
just last
it.
Week at Nietzsche's.
I was there. All right.
Excellent.
I'm drinking.
Oh, I just graduated college. How about that, guys? What about you? Yeah. Kind of a big deal, but whatever. Thanks. I should mention I graduated with an English degree. Yep. Which I'm starting to find out means jack shit. Everybody's like, English? Oh, are you going to teach? I ended up with like a 2-1. What the hell am I going to teach? The alphabet? Come on, let's be serious. I'm going to miss college. I appreciate the little things in college. Like, if you're in a college class and you have to go to the bathroom, you just get up and go. I think that's great. Because remember you're in grammar school, you had to put up with that bullshit where you raise your hand and be like, hey, can I go to the bathroom, please? The teacher looked down, was it an emergency? Is it an emergency? What the hell was that? She expects some crazy story. My dad was in a car accident. The only way he's gonna live is if I pee on his forehead. Emergency! What if I grab my pants during the spelling test? Would that be an emergency? I'd like to go now, please. Teachers, they're tough. I'm kind of out of sorts. I think I kind of lost track of what I was going to do up here because Kristen mentioned the anti-rape condom.
Sorry, guys.
I can't stop thinking about it. I don't care how bad your neighborhood is. I mean, I can't speak for women, but I don't know anybody who's putting a bear trap inside their vaginal.
You know the
maybe you would, okay. Speaking of safe sex, though, I think we should talk about something. Surprised at how many kids my age, how many kids in college don't practice safe sex. They say it's too embarrassing to buy condoms. Have you heard this? Come on, guys, suck it up. Too embarrassing to buy condoms? Get over yourself. I'll tell you what's embarrassing. Returning condoms. You ever tried that? Just walking into Wegmans thinking I'll get my money back for these. Bought them a year ago, haven't even opened the box. Just put them on the shelf and sell them to somebody cool and appreciate them. I'm not getting any is where I'm going with that. All right, that's my time. I'm Brian Herberger. Thank you very much.
Get this, but Greg still hasn't shown up. But Paolo Wachowiak is here to act as an audience. And I haven't seen Paula since the first time.
Overwhelming.
Woo! Greg!
There's only four of us. We can only do so much.
Yeah. We didn't bring the applause track with us. But I haven't seen Paula since Greg Sterling's tried stand-up comedy for the first time at Flappy's. When he took off all of his clothes and made our friend Tawny touch his nipples.
Borderline assault.
Yeah. So speaking of which, do you ever feel like you expose yourself like too much in your comedy?
Yes.
I mean, I don't know. Have you ever returned to condoms, really?
Well,
because it's just the best
receipt,
line ever.
They don't really want them back. And you save the receipt.
There are limits.
And when you buy condoms, usually you're pretty excited about things, and surely you don't think there'll ever be that moment.
Yeah.
But when they have to bring them back.
They expire like 3 years down the road.
So. Oh, maybe you get a little brother or something. You can pass them down.
they look good on the shelf. They do. You got to have them.
No, I have trouble that I can't lie. I have a horrible time lying. So when I get up and I actually tell you stories about my personal life, they tend to be true. And I just, some of the things Kristen has said, I just hope to God aren't really true.
My mother yells at me on occasion.
Hello, Chrissy.
Yeah, the first time she saw that bit, she was like, I don't talk like that.
Okay, we're going to show that bit later on, so they'll get a pretty good image of what the rest of the world thinks your mother talks like.
I think she sounds like that.
Do you?
Yeah. A little. It depends on how pissed off she is. Depends on her mood, whether the Jersey slot machine voice comes out or if it's just regular old Pat.
It should be on like the director's cut, like the deleted scenes. Kristen's mom's voice. That'd be
just my mom following me around. I don't sit with a rolling pin.
I don't know why Kristen thinks I talk like that. Like when I do my mother with a Scottish accent, and she really tried so hard her whole life to disguise the Scottish accent, and it would just piss her off if she thought that's how I was doing her. So I don't know. And we don't really believe you eat ramen noodles.
I do.
You do?
I believe it.
I absolutely don't cook at home.
No, don't you like steal food from work to take home? When I worked in dining, that's all I did.
Depends on the restaurant.
Were you cooking it, though?
Are any of you cops? Damn it, I always forget to ask.
were you cooking the food in the dining, or were you serving?
I was cooking and serving and usually leaving with a big box of Captain Crunch under my coat.
Mm. Dude, we don't have Captain Crunch.
You cook Captain Crunch? Like deep fried?
I'd definitely take that home.
Yeah. I got Captain Crunch recipes you'd not believe.
Wow. Did you work at the soup kitchen?
I went to Cornell Dining. Did I mention I went to Cornell? Kristen totally dissed me last week.
Unintentionally.
She was introducing me and she said, well, I don't know, maybe Suzanne's a comic genius in disguise. And I'm like, I've been doing comedy for you every week for 3 months.
You're good at disguises.
I'm not trying to hide anything.
You're good at disguises. You're a master of illusion.
No, really, that's all I have, Kristen, is what you see. I've totally maxed it
She's
out.
She's saving it, saving the good stuff.
Yeah. All right, well, let's see if Kristen can do any better.
Oh.
Kristen is the host of Tuesday Nights at Nietzsche's, and 1 week we made her go on for like a half hour and do her own stuff, and this is a clip from that.
Yes.
So I work with a bunch of girls that wear lots of corsets and underwear and stuff. I don't know if you've heard of the stripteasers. I work with them, right? Yeah, they're pretty cool. But, so, the thing is, I like hanging out with them, but they like to shop. And I like to hold purses, apparently. So I go with them. So we go into a Victoria's Secrets. Now, mind you, me and a Victoria's Secrets, kind of like Elton John and Home Depot. I know there's shit I need, but I have no idea what I'm supposed to do with it. This girl comes up to me, we'll call her Kitty. Kitty says, "Hi! Today we have three thongs for $19.99. That's cool. I can go to Walmart, get three pairs of underwear for $6. All gonna become thongs eventually, Phoenix. We all know cotton shrinks in the heat. It's just how it is. You know. Yeah. I was like, no, Kitty, what I really need is a bra. And Kitty said, well, would you like a wonder, a bottom, a back, as a strap, as a max measure, minimize, or an adhesive? Adhesive? Does anybody know what an adhesive bra is? Ladies, anybody? Drag queens, anybody? No? Let me tell you, an adhesive bra is when you take a bosom and you lift it and you tape it with something akin to duct tape. Which is fine and dandy at 7 o'clock. Fellas, when you take her out to dinner, or ladies, whatever, and you're looking across the table and you're like, oh, waiter, whatever the lady wants. Oh, wonderful. Fast forward, it's midnight, you're three bottles of wine into the night. And you're thinking you're getting lucky. Hey, baby. It's in the back, it's in the front. Nothing says not getting laid like ripping boob flesh, people. The nipples are important for every, most important actually of the whole thing. The nipple intact, important. It's good to keep it that way. Now, my mom has come along, her and my dad both, actually. My mom calls me up the other day. Ring, ring, ring. Hello. Chrissy! Chrissy, your father and I, we don't mind that you're homosexual. We're just afraid you're not very good at it. Now, between you and I, she's not listening. This isn't something I really want to have to prove to my mom, okay? Well, Mom, I don't know what you want me to... Chrissy, we have an idea. Okay, what is it? How long has it been? How long has what been? Since with a man. How long has it been since you were with a man with the penis? Well, a man with a penis, well. I was like, like 10 years. About 10 years. Perfect, Chrissy, perfect. Okay, remember when you were 12, you hated broccoli? Yeah. You love broccoli now. Yeah. Do you think it could be like broccoli? Do I think what could be like broccoli? The penis. And that's where you hang up because it seems appropriate, right? I don't know if penis is an acquired taste.
Oh, God.
I really don't. But I'm pretty sure that if it looks like broccoli, I should run in the opposite direction. And I am pretty sure if it tastes like broccoli, I've got a tough decision to make. And, and if you have mothers, I don't know if you do, but if you have mothers, and you hang up on them and they're not done, what's gonna happen? They're gonna fucking call you back. And keep calling until you answer. Hello, Chrissy. Just Just remember we love you no matter what. Thanks, Mom. But back to the penis thing. I don't think it's me. Is it because of me that you're gay? Well, I don't think so. Do you know something I don't know? And if you do, would you be so kind as to not jog that memory for me? Because I apparently have blocked that shit out. No, Chrissy, nothing like that. But I don't understand what happened. I don't understand where we went wrong. What do you mean? You see, when you were little, I couldn't get you to eat a tuna sandwich to save your life. But all day long, you were stuffing a sausage in your mouth. What happened? What did I do wrong? Did you people just groan at the sausage joke? Yeah? From Mom? My mom doesn't have a penis, for Christ's sake. She's Italian. She has a hairy penis. I gotta go. Thank you guys for coming down.
And we're back. I guess Greg hasn't called yet, but I'm sure just something's holding him up.
Traffic.
But does your mom know you said that about her?
Yes. The first time she heard that bit, I had invited her, my father and her, to a bar in New Orleans, a homosexual bar. It's the first time my dad ever stepped foot in one, the first time he's ever heard me say I was a big dyke, and the first time I've ever had a microphone and a spotlight on me while I was saying it. And she went into the bathroom, and she followed me in afterwards, and she said, you know, I don't talk like that.
That's what she's worried about.
And all, like, everybody that was in the bathroom, that they were my friends or whatever, she just went, I don't talk like that. I don't talk like that. She said that voice actually came from when we moved to Louisiana. All of my southern friends, that's what their interpretation of my mother was. But whenever they would do my mom, it was always, Chrissy, come here. And because they weren't used to that.
The
she was a northern Italian woman, and they were southern and chipper. So they weren't really sure what to do with that. Hey, can I do this?
Adhesive? Yes, you can.
Okay.
Yeah, Kristen's got something
I had
to
mentioned
promote.
The strip teasers. Where am I going? I'm going right there? Okay. So, ooh. starting next weekend, the 14th, 15th, and 21st, and 22nd of July at the New Phoenix Theater. Full-length burlesque. 2 hours of sketches and striptease numbers, and I will be hosting, and Suzanne will be stage managing.
I'll be pushing the buttons.
Brian will be in the audience, and Kevin will too, with his big hands in his pockets, I have a feeling.
But if you get it, if you see this poster anywhere throughout Western New York, take a good look at it, because it's very funny.
It's very Monty Python. There's a gymnast, or what is that? The trapeze artist trying to catch a nipple, really. And then you can put it this way, I found out. And then you're stepping on the police officer's head, which I think is kind of fun.
Oh, I like that.
Yeah, it's kind of fun. And, yeah, you know, some kind of homoerotic fellas holding her up, which I'm not sure about.
Homoerotic.
When you say
I don't even know what that means.
Oh, yeah,
they're like
marathon guys.
They're like marathon balleters or something. I don't know. Check it out.
Right.
It's pretty
like
cool.
It.
But it's going to be a fantastic show.
It's
going
to be a fantastic show.
Yes.
So, and, of course, by the time this airs, it'll be every Tuesday at Nietzsche's.
Every Tuesday at Nietzsche's.
That we do in time. And it's building a really good audience. I have to say.
It's fun.
Yeah, you could hear there was just enough laughter on the tapes that you could hear what was going on. And Kristen and I went to Toronto to do an open mic up there. And a lot of the comics there have kind of gotten wind of.
Yeah, we're
the
building
room.
A little something here. They want to come down.
And comedy's fun, by the way. Because I think many of you, like if you've seen me here before, you may notice I'm missing a yellow dog. And that makes me very, very sad. And so I started doing comedy, and it has totally cheered me up.
It's like Suzanne's best friend.
It's like having a dog.
It's like having...
With other people.
With other people.
Sitting next to Kevin's like having a dog.
He is fun to pet. He is really fun to pet, Kevin.
Take what I can get, that's fine.
Kind of easy to pick on. So, but there are other comedy nights around Mr. Denny's on Fridays.
Friday nights.
In Black Rock. Comics Cafe has stuff that's going on all the time.
Flappies on Wednesdays? Is that still
Flappies
going on?
Flappies on every Wednesday.
And what about the Shadow Lounge?
Shadow Lounge is at the first Wednesday of every month. So okay. We've just missed
that
going on. And they're starting the Gong Show at the Comics Cafe, which is going to feature some comics. Right.
And we do the burlesque every Thursday night at Roxy's on Main Street, which is a comedy.
So really, all of you who are sitting at home on a Friday night and trying to figure out why it is that you're sitting at home on a Friday night, it's because you have to write this stuff down.